Today we're going to talk about section 7A, specifically probability, for this video. There's going to be another video to talk about odds. So we say the probability of an event tells us basically the chance that it will happen. And the probability is always a number between 0 and 1. If the probability is 0, that means that the event is impossible. It's not going to happen. An example of that would be rolling a 7 on a 6-sided die. The only numbers on a 6-sided die are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, so it's impossible to roll a die and get a 7. A probability of 1 means that the event is definitely going to happen. Think back to that die for a moment. If we were to find the probability of rolling a number less than 7, well, since all the numbers are less than 7, the probability would be 1. It is certain. It will definitely happen. So it's important to remember that probabilities can be 0, probabilities can be 1, or they can be anywhere in between. And the closer they are to 0 or 1, that tells us the odds of it not happening are happening. If the probability is 0.5, that means there's a 50-50 chance it'll happen. Or if the probability is 0.75, there's a good chance it will happen. So you can tell how likely something is to occur based on how close that number is to 0 or 1. When we're calculating probabilities, one of the first things that we'll almost always do is figure out the sample space. And a sample space is just a listing of all the possible outcomes that could happen. And sometimes we don't necessarily even need to know what all of those outcomes are per se, we just need to know the number of things that could happen. For example, let's say that you're tossing a coin. If you toss one coin, you could either get a heads or a tail. So there's two items in the sample space. And if you notice on the PowerPoint, you see it says S equals squiggly bracket H comma T close squiggly bracket. That's saying the sample space, capital S, is, and then we list out the possibilities in the squiggly brackets. If you are listing out the sample space, you must do it in those squiggly brackets for it to be mathematically correct. So we write H for heads and T for tails. So we're saying the sample space of flipping one coin is a head or a tail. Now if we flip two coins, we could have a head, or a head and a tail, or a tail and a head, or a tail and a tail. So we have four choices for flipping two coins. That's our sample space, and there's four items in it. And one thing that's interesting is that if you have a coin, it has two options, heads or tails. And if you have another coin, it also has two options, heads or tails. So if you multiply the two choices for the first coin times the two choices for the second coin, that gives you four total choices. Now let's up it to having three coins. So we have three coins. Each one could be a head or a tail. So I've listed out all the possibilities there in our nice squiggly brackets. And if you think about the size of the sample space, each coin has two choices and there's three of them. So if we do 2 times 2 times 2, that gives us the 8 total choices. And if you count, there are 8 items in the sample space. Let's do another example about sample space. Let's say that Denise wants to ride her horse. She has 7 bridles, 5 saddle pads, 3 saddles, and 4 girths. And I'm not an equestrian person, but I believe that the bridle is what goes over the horse's face, the saddle pad goes between the horse and the saddle for cushioning, the saddle is what you sit in on the horse's back, and the girths go underneath the belly to help keep the saddle on. And if I'm wrong, please send me an email, but I believe that's what those things are. So if she has to select one of each, and she wants to know the total number of combinations that she could have, we would take the 7 times the 5 times the 3 times the 4 to get 720 ways. And here's an example where you don't want to list out all 720 possibilities. That's a lot of work. Often, again, we don't necessarily care what the possibilities are, we just need to know how many of them that there are. So let's do one and actually find a probability. So let's say, assuming there's an equal chance of having a boy or a girl, we want to find the probability of 2 girls and 2 boys. You see that big P? That says find the probability, and then whatever's inside the parentheses is what we're finding the probability of. So we're trying to find here the probability of having 2 boys and 2 girls. And you might initially think, oh, that's going to be 50%. You know, half the babies are boys, half the babies are girls, but actually it doesn't work out that way. Sometimes it helps me to create a chart of all my different scenarios. So here you see that I have all the combinations of boys and girls you could have if you're having 4 kids. So you could have no boys, 4 girls, 1 boy with 3 girls, and so on. And then beside it, I listed out the birth order that you could have to get that possibility. So if you're going to have 4 girls, you have to have a girl, then a girl, then a girl, then a girl. If you're going to have 1 boy and 3 girls, the boy could be born first, second, third, or fourth. And so on with the rest of them, listing out all the different possibilities to have that many boys and that many girls. And one thing that's interesting, if you think about a baby, it has two possibilities. It could be a boy or a girl. And with four babies, that means you're going to have two choices for the first one, two choices for the second, two for the third, and two for the fourth. So if you take the 2 times 2 times 2 times 2, that gives you the 16 items in the sample space. So sometimes it's good to know how many items there are if you're thinking about listing them all out so that you'll know if you found all of them or not. And if you count up our possibilities, there are 16 of them listed. So then if we want to find the probability of two girls and two boys, we'd see that there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ways to do that in the 2-boy, 2-girl row out of the 16 total possibilities. So it's actually not 0.5, it's a little bit less than 0.5, which isn't what you'd necessarily expect, but that's how we would find the probability of two boys and two girls. There are three types of probabilities that we can work with. The first one is theoretical, and theoretical is when everything is equally likely. I call these like the textbook situations a lot of times. It's like drawing a card out of a deck of cards, or rolling a die, or flipping a coin. It's something where everything is equally likely to occur and everything's nice and fair. So to find the probability of an event, and we're just using the capital letter A to represent some arbitrary event, we would look at the number of ways that A could occur divided by the total number of observations. So if we wanted to find the probability of drawing a queen out of a deck of cards, well, there's 4 queens in the deck divided by 52 total cards. So the probability of drawing a queen would be 4 out of 52. The chance of drawing any card is all the same. It's theoretical. In contrast, we have empirical probability, which is based on observations or experiments. This is when we actually go out and we collect data and then we do probabilities with that. So to find the probability of some type of experimental event happening, we just count up the number of times it occurred divided by the number of data points that we collected, or the number of trials. So maybe we wanted to find the probability of randomly picking a girl out of a class. Well, in y'all's class, there are 43 students, and 28 of y'all are girls. So the probability of picking a girl out of your class would be 28 over the 43 students that we have. Again, that's based on real-life data, so it's empirical. And subjective probability is just an educated guess. We don't really do a whole lot with subjective probability because it's not mathematical or sound in any way. It's just somebody using their gut instinct to say, you know, oh, I think there's going to be a 50% chance of rain today, especially if they're not a weatherman and they have no data. They're just kind of making a guess. So another example of theoretical. We roll a 6-sided die, and we want to find the probability of rolling a number less than 3. So the probability of a number less than 3, that we have the choices 1 or 2. Those are the only numbers less than 3 on a die. And then it's 6-sided die, so our sample space size is 6. So we have 2 choices out of the 6 possibilities, so our probability is 2 out of 6. And this is probably a good time for me to tell y'all that I never want you to reduce fractions. Save yourself the hassle and make it a little bit easier for me to grade. Always leave your fractions as unreduced. That way I can see exactly what you're thinking, and it's a lot easier to give partial credit, and you minimize the chance of you making a silly fraction mistake, because sometimes fractions can be tricky. So just leave it as 2/6. I don't want you to write it as 1/3 or anything. I mean, if you do, it's counted correct. I'm not going to take off for reducing as long as you reduce correctly, but you don't have to take the time to bother to reduce. Looking at an empirical example, let's say that you collect data from your class about their favorite kind of pet. 16 students prefer a dog, 21 students prefer a cat, 4 students prefer some other kind, and 9 students do not like any kind of pet. Let's say we want to find the probability that somebody prefers cats. Well, out of our class, there's 21 students that like cats, and if you add up all the different answers, 16 plus 21 plus 4 plus 9, that gives you 50, so there are 50 responses. So the probability that somebody prefers a cat is 21 out of 50. A subjective example, let's say that you ask your friend about the probability of you getting into NC State, and she says, oh, you have a good chance, maybe 60%. She doesn't know. She's not an admissions officer, most likely. She's just throwing out a number. So that would be subjective. One thing that's really helpful is to make a probability distribution. And this is just a table showing all the possibility of possible events and the probability of each one occurring. So think back to that coin example we did on slide 4, where we listed out all the different things that could happen if we flip 3 coins. we saw that there were 8 different possibilities. And within 3 coins, if you flip it, you could have 0 heads if you got all tails, or you could have 1 head, or you could have 2 head, or you could have all 3 coins showing up as a head. So our possibilities, if we're flipping 3 coins, are 0, 1, 2, or 3 heads. So we're listing out all the possibilities in the first column. Then if you go back and count, out of the 8 possibilities, 1 of them had 0 heads. If we got tell, tell, tell. So there was a 1 out of 8 chance of getting 0 heads. If you go back and count the number of ways to get 1 head and 2 tells, there were 3 of them. And similarly, there were 3 ways to get 2 heads and 1 tell. And then there was only 1 way to get 3 heads, and that's if we had head, head, head. So we list out the probability of getting 0, 1, 2, or 3. And this is a probability distribution. Again, it shows us all the possible events and the probability of each one occurring. Another example, let's say we roll two 6-sided dice. So we have 2 dice, and each one has the numbers 1 through 6 on it. So our probability is, what is the probability that the sum is 7? So anytime you're doing something where you're doing 2 actions and you're adding them or multiplying them, I find it really helpful to make a chart. So in my chart, pretend the column going across, or the row going across, represents 1 die, and then the column going down represents another. So that row across the top represents 1 of the die, and we could get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 on it. Then the column going down represents the other die, and we could get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. And so then what I would do is I would take the first row and the first column, saying we get a 1 on the first die and a 1 on the second die, add them together and get a 2. So the sum would be 2 if we rolled a 1 and a 1. Similarly, if we go across, if we got a 2 on the first die and a 1 on the second, 2 plus 1 gives us a sum of 3. So by going through and adding up all the different combinations of die 1 and die 2, we get our sample space, showing us all 36 sums that we could get. And you can do this exact same thing if it's talking about multiplying them or subtracting them or any other thing where you're doing something. Make a chart showing all the different combinations of die 1 and die 2. So once we list out all 36 sums that we can get, to find the probability that the sum is a 7, all we would have to do is count how many ways are there to get a 7. And if you go up that diagonal, see that there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different ways that we could get a sum of a 7. So the probability of a sum of a 7 is those 6 possibilities out of our 36 total possibilities. And again, leave that number as an unreduced fraction. I do not want you to simplify it. I'd rather you just leave it as is to minimize your chance of making a silly mistake.